those that are troubled, those that are incarcerated, hospitals. Remember our leaders this morning from all phases. Remember this country, even this world. You know, it is a bad time for a lot of folks. And thank God that we have the protection and provision that we do have. You know, I simply say you just don't know what it's like to have bomb bursting on your head. You don't know what it's like to have to go through rubble every day to find food or whatever. Have a job and can't get to it. You know, have health issues and not taken care of. You know, we just don't know. So we just praise God for the wonderful things that He is doing for us and allowing us to happen. Let us pray this time. Gracious Father in heaven, we come before you today and we thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. You, Lord. Hallelujah. Nobody but you, Lord. Hallelujah. That's providing for us, who's taking care of us, oh God. That's touched our hearts, oh God. You stirred us this morning. You woke us up, oh God. And we just give you praise, honor, and glory, oh God. And we open our eyes, oh God, to just to be able to look upon your beauty, oh God. Imagine in our minds, oh God, how great you are, oh God. We just thank you, oh Lord. We just give you praise. We honor you, oh God, for being our Savior. We thank you so much, oh God, because you've chosen us, oh God. Hallelujah. You see where we were, hallelujah. Oh God, and you reached down into a pit, oh God, and you pulled us up, hallelujah. Oh God, we thank you for just giving us a desire to say yes, Lord, hallelujah. This morning, hallelujah. Oh God, of your goodness and your wonder, oh Lord. Hallelujah. We give you praise, Lord, this morning. We thank you, Lord, for just touching our hearts. Thank you, Lord, for giving us the love that we have, oh God. And Lord, not only that, Lord, but how you're working on us, Lord, that we might love even more, oh God. That we might do those things which are right in your sight, Lord. Hallelujah. We thank you, oh God, for determination, oh God, to walk with you, oh God, no matter what. Hallelujah. We give you praise, Lord, this morning. That we're able to walk in here with our own 2 feet, oh God. We're able to think, oh God, and we're clothed with our right minds, oh Lord. The activity of our limbs, oh God, we just thank you, hallelujah. Oh God, our hearts, hallelujah, been given by you, Lord. Oh God, we thank you, oh God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh God, we just give you praise, Lord, today. Oh God, we magnify your name, oh God, for the name above every name. Oh God, we lift you high, hallelujah. Oh God, but you're better to us than we've even been to ourselves, oh God. We just give you praise, oh God. Now, Lord, we're asking you to bless each and every one here under the sound of my voice, even those, hallelujah, in radio land, oh God. We're asking you to touch them, oh God. Strengthen them, oh God. Open up their understanding to your word, oh God. Help them to embrace you, oh God, to grab hope while they have the opportunity, my God. Oh God, that we'll come to you, Lord, before it's everlasting too late. Yes. Oh God, that we give you the opportunity to lead us in this world, oh God, and prepare us for the world to come. We give you praise, Lord, this morning. Asking you to bless every request, oh God, that's going forth, Lord. Touch our hearts. Move upon us in the precious name of our Lord Jesus. We thank you. We thank you. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Greatness is will meditate on the glorious splendor of your majesty. That is so rich. Thank you, Jesus. And on his and on your wondrous works. Men should speak of the might of your awesomeness. And I will declare your greatness. They shall utter the memory of your great goodness and shall sing of your righteousness. The Lord is gracious and full of compassion, slow to anger and great in mercy. Praise the Lord for that. Thank you, Jesus. The Lord is good to all, and his tender mercies are over all his works. All your works shall praise you, O Lord, and your saints shall bless you. I'm going to read that one more time. All your works shall praise you, O Lord, and your saints. Are we the saints this morning?
Yes.
And your saints shall bless you. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. That's
oh, my God.
Thank you. out there. How many worshipers? To give him honor and praise. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. unto the glory of God. Hallelujah. We bless your holy name. God is good. He is great. And he's greatly to be praised. Amen. Hallelujah. Anytime you need something, just go into a praise. Worship him. Changes the atmosphere. Amen. We know that it's a weapon. It confuses the enemy. So anytime we need the enemy to go, begin to worship. Amen. Begin to praise. Hallelujah. Lift his name up.
Yeah. Victory in Jesus.
I find my
have victory in him. He is a good God. He is merciful and he is kind. Amen. Amen. We are thankful unto him and we bless his holy name. If you love the Lord, clap your hands. If he's been good to you, stomp your feet. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If he allowed you to wake up this morning with breath in your body, say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lord, we bless you. We magnify you. You are good. And your mercy endureth forever. We are grateful. Hallelujah. I can't thank him enough. Way back in the day, we used to sing this song. If I had 10,000 tongues, I couldn't praise him enough. Amen. And for that, I am grateful. I can't thank him enough for all he's done for me. Hope he's been good. And he is good all the time. He is good. He is not one of those individuals, I guess you would say, that would, you know, just is conditional. If you didn't do right, I don't do right. You know how we can be tit for tat, can't we? Right? But he's not like that. He loves us unconditionally without agape love. Say agape. Hallelujah. It's unconditional. And it doesn't matter. Sometimes we've done wrong intentionally, but he still loved us. Hallelujah. For God, so what? Love the world that he loved. He gave his only begotten son. He gave. Amen. So that means sometimes we got to give too. Hallelujah. At this time, call on our pastor, Pastor John Lee. Let's receive him by saying amen. Amen.
Church, you can sing, or you cut the grass, or whatever you do, so pour and pray for the saints. God sees you, and he sees the sacrifice. So, typically, Old Testament sacrifices were not pleasant. You take an animal, you pay for that animal, and you sacrifice that animal according to the law. And in the New Testament, the Bible says we are to present our bodies as a sacrifice. That's why you engage your hands when we praise God. In your mouth, in your sing, and in your body, in your life. So we thank God for those things. I want to talk this morning about family. If you have your Bibles, let's go to Psalms 3 and 3. Before we go to Psalms 3 and 3, let's go to 2 Samuel 15 and 30. And one of my scriptures was behind me. That might help if you can see it. The other one was not, and that's 2 Samuel. I believe Samuel comes before the Psalms. So I'll read 2 Samuel 15. You can be seated this morning. I'm just going to teach a little bit. Thank the Lord for the ministers this morning to share. 2 Samuel 15 to 30, one scripture, and then one scripture in Psalms 3 and 3. I'm thankful I have a daughter here this morning, all the way from Terre Haute, Indiana. She's driving now. She was behind me yesterday on 465. And she would fall behind and I'd call her and say, hurry up! You can't foot around out here on the highway. You got to keep going. My brother-in-law told me, he said, over about an hour or an hour and a half, I don't want to drive no further than that. And I'm about with you right there, Pastor Boyd. He does some heavy driving. But, we pray for her. She's on this highway. You know, people deal with road rage and everything else. I had a guy throw a bottle at my car in Indianapolis, a water bottle. Water splashed all over it and reached to the side of my seat. And my wife looked at me and said, are you saved or are you not saved? I said, oh, yeah, I'm saved. I couldn't reach down there. Well, I thank God for her today. And we ask for protection for all those who are driving and on the road. Because it's a crazy world.
2 Samuel 15:30. But David continued up the Mount of Olives a bit, I guess, weeping as he went. His head was covered and he was barefoot. And all the people with him covered their heads too and were weeping as they went up. I'll read that again since it's just us here. 2 Samuel 15:30. But David continued up the Mount of Olives. Look at somebody say, keep going.
Keep going.
Whatever happens, keep going. Weeping as he went, his head was covered, he was barefoot. All the people with him covered their heads too, and weeping as they went up. We'll go to Psalms 3:3, familiar portion. But you, O Lord, are a shield for me, my glory, and the one who lifts up my head. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading, hearing, teaching, understanding of his word. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen.
Family is an important thing in life, and to me it's the most important. When we look to the Bible, it doesn't open up with something so obvious and evident as the salvation that you're in need of. But it starts with a family that God made from the beginning. He gave us a model of what family is supposed to look like. I remember 70, Webster defined a family as a husband and a wife and possibly kids, and they said possibly a pet. Now that was the definition of a family. It took a man and a woman, and then they said maybe some kids if you want the kids, you don't have to have the kids. But that was a family and possibly a pet. Today, the family is not the same as it used to be. But the Bible outlines what a family is.
Amen.
God's word is true.
Yes.
And we thank him for his word.
Amen.
But I think he wanted us to know from the beginning what is important in life. That family is important. We're not to neglect our family. My favorite prophet, Samuel, the Bible says every year he went back home. And it always blesses me. I watch people sometimes and they never come back home. My brother Brian always comes back. Let's give Brian a hand. There's something valuable to him about family now. And he doesn't come from Terre Haute, Indiana. He comes from Germany. That's a long way. How long was that flight?
10 hours
over here. Yeah, I can do that. I'm still in Germany right now. That is a long flight, you know, with anxiety and all that stuff. I don't know that I would have to take something to put me to sleep, wake me up when we get there. So, you hear me? And he comes back because family is important. He doesn't come back. I know I'm supposed to speak for him this morning. He doesn't come back because life is perfect. He doesn't come back because he's a billionaire, but he plans a yearly trip to come back and see his family. And for that, I think he is surely admired and appreciated by me and no one else. But I think it's important to understand that in our faith, God wants our faith to affect how we deal with our family. A lot of times people, they have faith and then they have family. No, the faith is supposed to affect how we treat our family. Remember, there's a lot to say about your family. From the very first, second book of the Bible, it tells them to do what to your father and your mother.
Honor.
Yeah, honor them. Our faith should affect how we treat our family. And if you have a father or your mother, surely you ought to consider what is honor look like. We surely want to honor them. Proverbs 22:6 tells us, of course, you know, that we ought to train up a child because it says foolishness is bound in them. So they need discipline. They need training. Because foolishness is in them. They do foolish things. And it says it's bound up in them, it's locked in them, it can't get out. This is what the Bible says about the kid. And a lot of times, 18 doesn't mean you're still not a kid, an adult, a childlike sometimes. And even past that portion. So the Bible and faith comes along to help us with our family. And we need to use those disciplines in the lives of our children to help them. Even when it's hard, as a loving grandma, and I'm a grandpa now, we went down to Greenwood, south of Indianapolis yesterday. My grandson turned 5, and he's a rough joker. You know, if he's you're holding, he might sock you here. So you can't play with him. Because when he gets older and he tries to sock somebody here, they're going to sock him here. So I had to train him up. So for his own good, for his own edification. Sometimes as we get older, we have to tell people we love, even as they get older, the truth. And we don't sock them in the jaw, but we tell them something that sometimes has to jolt them a little bit. Say, oh, no, I didn't know this was true about me. So, yeah, this is true, and I'm telling you this out of love. Remember that. 1 Timothy 5:8 says, if anyone does not take care of their relatives, now, and especially members of his household, he has denied his own faith. And it is incongruous for me to preach and teach and then not pay my child support. Or preach and teach and not take care of my children or not look after my father. It says true faith ratifies it. So if you truly have faith, it will affect how you treat your family. 1 Timothy 5:8, if anyone does not provide for his relative, and especially for members of his household, he has denied faith, and listen to this, he's worshiping an unbeliever. I think it's because we're being hypocritical sometimes. And this is something we have to sort of guard and watch, because family, again, can be difficult. Anybody, can I get a second on that sometimes?
Amen.
And if you don't believe they can be difficult, I can ask them if you are difficult. Because I'm sure I'll get an amen back that way. I'm convinced that I can be both difficult and people can be difficult with me. I had a sciatica or something going on this week, and my wife said, hold it now, you're talking a little rough. And I said, honey, it's my back. My patience is going. Just work with me here. I'm dealing with pain, and it's affected me. But she had to bring me back on in the check. Colossians 3:20. We go to the New Testament as well. Children, obey your parents in everything. Why? He said, because this pleases the Lord.
Yes.
It's pleasing to God for you, your child, to obey you. A lot of times we got kids in church and we say something to them and mom and daddy get mad and next thing you know they miss the church. But we just teach them the word of God. We want the kid to obey you. That way they'll respect everybody else. But they won't respect nobody if they don't respect their own parent. And of course that starts us at an early age. We let the word of God come into our heart, dwell into our heart for our edification and our good. Thy word have I hid in my heart, that I might not sin against him. That is why we love his word. Amen. Anybody love the word this morning? Even when it comes to being a pastor, the Bible says, how can you manage a church if you don't know how to take care of your own house? So I make sure that we're holding good court in our home and that things are orderly. And sometimes we have to declare Joshua 24:15. Maybe it's 25:14, but it's one of them. But as for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord.
Amen.
I don't know what y'all do across town. Y'all carry on, and that's fine. But in our house, we're going to serve the Lord.
Amen.
It doesn't mean it's not going to be a fun house. That ain't mean we're going to have a good time. But we're going to uphold as best we can good order and have peace in our house. And above all, let the love be shown.
Yes.
We try to make sure our house is a loving home. And we've got a few witnesses here that have come out, and family and friends who have ate with us, and hopefully they felt love if nothing else. So we find out from the very beginning, God has declared family and its importance. He says in Genesis, he says, but this call, I want a man to leave his father. And he didn't say hang with his father, leave his father and his mother and hold fast to a wife. You know, that's one thing that God has ordained in life, and we know that God has given some people the special ability to remain single, and that's not to disregard that. But in general, I think family is important, and even when those two come together, they go back and return to be one flesh anyhow. So whether or not you're single or you're married, you still one. Can I get a couple men to say amen? You understand that you have to advise her, find out from her what's going on, and we don't make no moves, and this is our money, this is our house, this is our car, and when those hours and that oneness goes out, then you got a problem. The math don't start working, because that's God's math. Those two have become one. They share a common life, physical, spiritual, emotional. When she's down, I'm down. When she's up, I'm up. I can't possibly be up and her be down. That doesn't make any sense. In March, my brother passed away, and we got the news coming next to the Dell building, and I just bawled. And I looked over, she was crying louder than I was. And I said, well, I said, there's someone who is in touch with the feelings of my infirmities. Thank God for family. Somebody said, thank God for family. The Bible says that if you may not talk to your brother every day, but there is a purpose for a brother. It says that a brother is born for times of adversity. Amen. A friend loves us all time, but a brother may not call you, but let somebody mess with you, sister. Let somebody mess with you, brother. Your sister or brother will be right there. It don't matter if they talk to you. Who did what and what did they do or where did I gotta go? Because that's what God has set that person for. A brother is there for times of trouble. If someone's trying to vex you and hurt you, God said that's what you call your brother for. Friend is always there for loving. But yet it says there is a friend now that even sticks closer than a brother. Anybody has some good friends? I know I have. Just friends have always been there. But I really think that verse speaks to Jesus Christ. He was surely closer than any family that we could ever have. When we look into the text today, we see really an embattled soldier of the cross, David, whose life will encourage you with his triumphs, and it will humble you with his tribulations, and it will give you a somber look at life through the tragedies that he had. In the vicissitudes of life are seen in the life of David, the ups and downs of what the Bible calls a man that is after God's own heart. Amen. A man who was far from perfect, but surely a person who loved God and didn't mind expressing his love for God. I always say real men worship God. We get on social media and it's always the women that tell you what a real man does. But let me tell you what a real man worships God. He don't mind getting on his knees and being prostrate to God. He doesn't mind humbling himself. You know, the humility, the depth of humility is based on the height of love. The lower you go, humble, the higher the love. Remember, it was Christ. The Bible said that he humbled himself, and God exalted him. So we thank the Lord for his word today. We thank God for this word today, and the battle of David who dealt with family. And I think it's safe to say that he did not make all the right choices as a father, and as a husband, and as a king. So in every aspect of his life, the Bible goes to show you that he made not small mistakes, but large mistakes. The man after God's own heart, the woman after God's own heart, is not going to be a perfect person. They're going to have to deal with what God has called them to do, and also they're going to have to learn to deal with family that can be difficult. This is a place where David did not think he would be in life. If we read through the text, he had been called, remember, from the sheep pasture by God at the age of 17. And God put an 18-year hold on his kingship. Now, it's a rough thing to know that you're king. You've been tagged for king, but you got to wait 18 years, really, or a lot of years before the realization of it. That means you're going to have to humble yourself because you have the gift. You have the grace, but yet the time has not come. I think a lot of times we struggle with timing. You know, we want stuff out of God's time, but we ought to understand that everything there is a season, a time, and a purpose under heaven. There's a time for us to come about. There's a time for us to come to God. There's a time for ministry. There's a time to have a family. There's a time to get married. There's a time to praise God. And that time is right now. Can I get two or three people to clap your hands? And somebody say, thank you, Jesus. And he's had a place in his life, but he didn't think he would be. It's a never thought. I call him a never thought. I never thought I'd be in this situation. I remember when I came to Muncie in 2012 and I didn't have a pot to use the bathroom in or a window to throw it out of, so to speak. I didn't have change in my pocket. I was from a broken relationship and family struggles, and I didn't have any land or cars, or didn't have a job. But I came here on a word from the Lord that that's what God wanted me to do. The call of faith always calls us out from something that is comfortable to us. To get anything great from God, you have to come out from what you used to do and used to be. God can't fill up a cup that's already full. You have to empty yourself of the old so that God can pour something new in.
Yes.
And we see David having to understand that, even though he had a background. And he addresses the Lord in our second verse as a shield and the glory and the lifter of his head.
Yes.
Three things. I like that. That's divine completeness now. Three things. His glory, and the shield, the glory, and the lifter of his head. That's what I want to talk about this morning. The Lord is your shield. Somebody say, he's my shield.
He's my shield.
Somebody say, he's my glory. And he's the lifter up of my head. A few years ago in the NCAA tournament, some of you watch basketball, a young man had a critical foul down toward the end of one of the games, and the CBS put him on display. He was dropping his head and walking down the court. And surely he was just really distraught. He had cost his team maybe the game. And one of his teammates came alongside him and lifted his head up. And they posted that picture all across the country as someone who is there to support you when you don't think there's any help for you and you made a mistake. God wants you to know this morning, he is able to lift your head up. And he is able to protect you. He's been protecting you. He's been your shield. He's been your lifter of your head. When you could lift your head, when you was down and out and struggling, it was God who lifted it down. It wasn't a friend, it wasn't social reform, and it wasn't politics, no. It was the Almighty God from heaven in his providence. He shed his grace and his love and his mercy on you. And when nothing else can lift your head, God can lift you up from a dark place. And I thank God this morning because I've been in some dark places in my life where I didn't have the fortitude. I acknowledged that I was spiritually poor. But I remember the Bible says, blessed are the poor in spirit, for they shall see God. And I thank God this morning for the times that he lifted up my head. David is at a point in his life where he is at a low point in life. He is not asking God to be his shield. He's not asking God to lift up his head or God to be his glory. He said, thou, O Lord, art my shield. He is making a confirmation of what God has done. And just as a shield protects a warrior and swords, darts and spears, David understood that it was God that was protecting him down through the years. He wanted to acknowledge God in song and acknowledge God in worship and acknowledge God with thanksgiving. And those things are important in the Christian life. It's not enough for God to bless you. We need to acknowledge God for what he's done. We need to worship God for what he's done. We need to clap our hands because God has been good. And you remember when God healed the lepers, he said only one was made whole. Only one was truly healed because he came back and gave God thanks. Your being whole is found in your thanksgiving. It's found in your worship. God wants to know that you are grateful for what he's done, for being your shield, for lifting you up when no one else can lift you up. Drugs can do it. Friends can do it. Hallelujah. But God been there to lift you up. He wants us to give him praise. This is not a petition. This is not a request for help. This is confirmation. No need here to get back on your knees to ask God. He gave these things to the believer when he hung Jesus on the cross.
Yes.
He lifted you up when he hung Jesus on the cross. Yes. Your glory came through the cross.
Yes.
One writer said the cross blazed with the glory of God, as a horrible darkness was outshined by the glory of the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Ephesians 1 says, praise be to God and the Father of our Lord Jesus, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing. Now David saying God is his help.
Yes.
Thousands of years later, Paul saying praise be to that same God.
Yes.
Because he gave us every blessing.
Yes.
In heaven.
Yes.
These blessings didn't come through social change and politics. It wasn't social economical status that changed in David's life. It wasn't more soldiers, but he understood that God was his help.
Yes.
Paul goes on to say in Ephesians, for he has chosen us before creation to be holy and blameless in his sight. We often want to try to decide who's saved and who ain't saved, but the fact is God has chosen us.
Yes.
God chose me.
Yes.
It's his right to choose. It's his prerogative.
Yes.
The Bible says that he did it in love, that he predestined us to adoption, to sonship through Jesus Christ. And we have redemption through the blood of Jesus Christ. Anybody got redemption this morning? Oh, it didn't come through prayer this morning. It came by the blood of Jesus. Forgiveness of sin according to what? The riches of his grace says he's lavished on us.
Yes.
The Bible says Jesus came to a point where he as a king did not have a pair of shoes. Sometimes we have come to places in our lives where we have low physical substance that God has not cast us out. He comes to a place, he's dealing with his son Absalom, who has tried to take over the kingship. Because sometimes family can be difficult. Sometimes family can be rough. And the Bible says it affected David like it should affect us. The Bible says he wept. He was down. And he was feeling real pain. This is a real man at a real time in history. It's a real king in the history of the present nation, Israel. What the Bible calls the greatest king in Israel. Had to endure a time where he was dealing with depression, when he was dealing with sadness and heaviness. One writer said, I come to the garden alone while the dew is still on the roses. He said, in the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses. But he walks with me and talks with me, tells me that I am his own. And the joy that we share when we tarry there, no one will ever know. Let me explain something to you, church. When you're going through, you still have help in God. When things are down, we still have help in God. If you know someone that's going through, you remind them today that they do have a help in God. The songwriter said, when we're down, he cheers us. When we're weak, he gives us strength. And when we're broke, he fixes us. And because of that, we know that God will never leave us. Thou, O Lord, are our shield. He is our glory and the lifter of our head. Give God some praise this morning. That's all I have. I'm going to give you the praise this morning. Praying I'll give you surgery this week. You are going to die. Battling this season. The things have been going. And it's good to remember where our help comes from. We have a lot of people that are intermediates to our help. Bishop provided me with his lawnmower to cut my grass, but before that, God moved to bless him, and we have these connections in church, but it's always God who is the ultimate provider. Never forget that. If you get a bad word from someone this week, remember that there is somebody greater than your problem. There is somebody greater than your struggle. There is somebody that can, when you can't lift your own head, God can come along and lift that head up. And I'll tell you what, there's the pain and the struggle that we go through that can't nobody know. And a lot of times, men, we try to act like we know, and then pain, child labor is rough. You don't know what child labor is like unless you gave a child. You ain't got no idea. If you was in that room, you didn't have no idea. All you hear was a weeping and a wailing, but you don't know what that thing feels like. But let me tell you what, there's somebody, and his name is Jesus Christ, that can lift your head. The Bible says that David climbed that hill, Olivet, and I remember Jesus climbed that same hill. And he endured and struggled, and he suffered, and he bled, and he wept, and he died, and he gave his life so that we might have eternal life today. Not so that we could walk around with our head hanging down, but we pop our head up and say, thank God, because I serve the Almighty God who reigns from heaven, who got all power and gives us the grace that we need. Paul said, my God shall supply. I believe it this morning. My God shall supply your needs according to his riches and glory. Give God some praise this morning. That's all I want. Sermon J.K. Rowling, she said she went through a dark period in her life, and she's a multi-billionaire now, and I don't read the books, but I appreciate her statement. And she said, rock bottom became the solid foundation upon which I built my life. Do you ever see life that way? Rock bottom. Rock bottom became the solid foundation. The lowest point in her life became the foundation on how she rebuilt her life. And God wants to get us all to that point because we lean on stuff. We lean on all kinds of stuff, and we think it's good ground. And God wants to get you broken down. Because all those faults, you know, woe to them who look to Egypt for help. If you're leaning on something other than the Almighty and the everlasting, you are on shaky ground. And until you turn your heart and recognize that there is a rock at the bottom, and that rock is Christ, and he wants that to be the point on which we build our lives. The rock, Jesus Christ, our help, and the lifter up of our head. I'm grateful this morning. I'll tell you what, I thank God for all that he has done for me personally, and the times that he's came and saw about me. I remember when my mother had a heart transplant when I was 16 or 17 years old, and she didn't have no help. It was 1987. But it wasn't available like that. It was a different scene to try to get an organ, and you surely wasn't getting no heart. But I told the Lord, I said, Lord, bless me. And I felt like the Lord let me know it was going to happen. Well, her heart got down to 4%. And she was in there, and we called all everybody to the hospital, and I said, Lord, you know I'm not going to make it. I'm 16. I ain't going to make it without my mom. I need her a little while longer. And in the last hour, the doctor came in and said, a young man in Russ's heart, he says, was on a motorcycle and lost his life. He said, his wife is here, and they want your mother to have her his heart. And I remember God is faith. Because my head was hanging down, and he came through and lifted me up. Hallelujah. And time after time, God has been faithful to us. He's been faithful to his people. And he's worthy of the praise and the glory and the honor for all that he has done. Hallelujah. And that is just one of the many times that he has done something that no one else can do. And when your head is down, they don't make a drum that can lift your head up. They don't make nothing powerful enough to lift your head up. When your heart is crushed and your soul is overwhelmed, who are you going to run to? You have to run to the rock that is higher than we are. And that rock is Christ this morning. Anybody got him this morning? Say, I got him. I know I got him. I got to have him in the morning. I got to have him in the evening and in the afternoon. And I am grateful this morning. Above all things, I'm grateful for family. But you know, you're going to have to deal with them like David did. Absalom caused David a lot of heartache and grief. His own son. A lot of heartache and grief. And if you're a father, you've been through it with your son. Yeah. Pastor Paul would say, I'll be with you. I got five kids. And if you're a son, you know you done gave it to your father sometimes, to be honest. And his daughter, too. But it's all a part of God showing his faithfulness and his goodness, you know. And we want to remember that he is there to lift you up. And a lot of times we're reaching in the dark for stuff that ain't going to help you. Just look to God. And look to God. And if you go to Israel, it's a hilly place. So they're always talking about, I look to the hills. And they're not joking because there were hills everywhere. It's a hilly country. But that was supposed to be really an allegory to show you that in prayer, look up. Look up. There's help. When he said that, you know, he was far from his appointed place of worship. But he knew if he looked up and just kept his eyes on where God was taking him to. Sometimes the terrain is rough. What is that thing? What did they say that when you ride, if you look down, you'll fall, but if you keep your head up, you'll stay balanced? Is it a unicycle or something? But that's what God wants us to do. He don't want you to look at the terrain. He didn't want us looking at all the trouble. And I'm not saying walk around with the blinders on. I'm saying don't let it be your focus. Your struggles are not your focus. Your failures are not your focus. And you look to the hills from which cometh your help. Our help cometh from the Lord. Let's give God one more praise. This time to give.
get you in service today and come and help with all. We'll put you to work all the way from vacation. You can come as you feel led.
Somebody who needs a church home.
Yes.
See if we can walk with them, get them. Gracious Father in heaven, we come before you once again and we thank you for your goodness and mercy, your loving kindness, oh God. We thank you for your word today, oh God. Encourage us, oh Lord, to help us, oh God, to know that thou art our Father, Lord, and that you are the one who helps us to walk together with love. Lord God, as we prepare to leave this place, go with us, oh Lord. Guide us and strengthen us, Lord. Bind us together with love, no matter where we are, oh God. We praise you and we give you honor and glory, oh God. Now, Lord, we ask you to touch our hearts today. Remember the places that we are going to, oh God. Touch the hearts of those we come in contact with, oh God. Encourage them, oh God, and you encourage us to lift up. We thank you and we give you praise, honor, and glory. In Jesus' name, let us say,
amen.
You are dismissed.
All right. Different way.
I don't know what I did, but